Let's rethink the performance foot. Good morning. Happy Friday. I have NeuroCoffee in hand and it is perfect. Man, that's good. Okay. Man, what a week. We had a killer week this week. Lots of things going on. Lots of really cool mentorship calls. Kind of had like, once again, the perfect storm of questions that came through this week. And there was a whole series of foot-related stuff that came through, some mentorship calls and some of the Q&As. And so I thought I would just wrap up Friday with a little bit of perspective on the performance-related foot, because I think it's still a little bit of a challenge for people because of some of the biases that have been created over time and some of the perspectives as to what constitutes a good performance foot versus one that is interference. And so I want us to look at this thing differently. Now, let me preface everything that I'm about to say is that performance is multifactorial. There are so many potential influences here. It's not just a foot thing. The foot is one part, but we're gonna talk about it in isolation to give you a little bit of perspective. So the things that you also probably need to consider is like, okay, what kind of an archetype are we dealing with? What are some of the proportional issues in physical structure? So the size of your thorax relative to the size of your pelvis is an influence in performance. Your proportions as far as, you know, the length of your axial skeleton to the length of the appendicular skeleton is an influence. Your force to weight ratio, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. So again, let's keep this in perspective, okay? The first thing we want to do then is we want to review a little bit about the simplified foot model, okay? So we're going to go through the phases of this foot position. So our traditional heel rocker would represent this early propulsive phase. So as I bring the medial calcaneus to the ground and I get the forefoot to the ground, then the toes are extended, the tibia is still behind the foot. So this is an eared position. So I still have an arch and I've got an eared tibia relative to the foot. And so that's my early propulsive foot. As I move through middle, this is where the arch is going to move down towards the ground. So this is your traditional pronation. This is tibial internal rotation. So this is a lower arch. Now, here's the key element of this that I want you to understand is that the maximum force into the ground is at maximum pronation. And where that is, max propulsion is just as that medial calcaneus re-breaks from the ground. And so this is actually a low position of the arch, because right after that, I'm gonna get a bunch of concentric orientation on the plantar aspect of the foot. This is what they traditionally call that windlass effect. And I'm gonna crank that sucker back into an externally rotated position, right? And that is traditionally considered this high propulsive foot, but the force application came just prior to that. And so this is the demonstration of what happens after that force production. And so when we talk about a performance-related foot, this is why we're gonna see lower arches on a lot of these really, really high performers. And so people look at these feet and they go, oh, these are really crappy feet, because pronation has always been described as this accommodative foot position, which is not untrue, but the highest force production also happens in maximum pronation. So that's where our max propulsion is. So when we look at feet like this, it can be a little confusing as to why we would see these low arches. But what they're actually doing is it's a time saver that allows these athletes to get to maximum propulsion much faster than what we would consider our non-athletic population. And so that's what they're representing. Now, we've got some subtle differences between these low arched feet as well that we can talk about. So if we have someone that is closer to maximum propulsion than, say, another athlete, what you're typically going to see under these circumstances is you'll see, if we were making a comparison in performance, we would see a better broad jump than a better than vertical jump. So it doesn't mean they're bad vertical jumpers. It just means that as a representation of where they perform the best, they are better at horizontal projection because they are so much closer to maximum propulsion than another athlete would be. And so they'll have the quicker first step, they'll have great acceleration. But what you're gonna measure, if you to throw them on the table, they're going to be biased more towards external rotation. So remember, as I break that foot, I get this concentric orientation that's going to move me quicker towards ER. So what happens is they have a reduced yielding strategy, which again, that dampens their ability to produce a vertical jump, but it also improves their horizontal projection. They're going to have limited hip flexion. They'll probably have limited straight leg raise, etc., that's associated with this external rotation bias and a reduced yielding strategy. If I move you back just slightly from max propulsion, I've now just increased the amount of time that you have between where you are as a representation of your center of gravity and maximum propulsion. So in doing so now, I've actually increased the time that you have to produce that yielding strategy. These are the people that will have a better vertical jump than broad jump as a representation, but they're gonna be a little bit slower in regards to change of direction, but they're gonna have better top speed because their vertical projections are better. They're gonna have slightly less external rotation bias, so they're gonna have a little bit more of an internal rotation capability than say our guys that are better horizontal projectors. And so they'll have a little bit better hip flexion, a little bit better straight leg raise. So if we look at a couple representations of feet, I'll try to show you the subtle little difference. So what we have right there is a pair of feet that can run a 4.440. So he is very, very good at acceleration. He is very, very good at change of direction. So this is a Division I football player, and he played 4 years of high level Division I football. This other representation right here, it looks very, very similar, but this is a better vertical jumper than a horizontal projector. And so this is actually a very, very high level basketball player. And so he's got a better vertical jump than horizontal projection. And so again, subtle differences as to how close these guys are to their maximum propulsion phase. Now, let me show you another pair of feet that don't jump very well and not very fast, but also on a very high level basketball player. So this individual has a much higher arch. He is positioned much more into an earlier phase. So he's a little bit slower. He doesn't jump as high and he's not as fast. It doesn't mean that he can't play high level basketball. It just means that he's going to rely on other things. This person also happens to be exceptionally tall. And so again, we have all of these representations. So again, everything's multifactorial from a performance perspective. There are many different ways that these people can perform. But what we want to start to think about is like, okay, I have these different feet, they're going to be better at different things, and is one element that supports this high level of performance. Now, let's take this into the clinic. So I can take these same concepts and I can start to look at my quote-unquote normal people from a very, very similar perspective. So when I see a pair of feet that might be more pronated, so the arch is lower to the ground, I might have this person that is struggling with gravity. And so they're in a situation where they're constantly producing a higher force into the ground because they're just not managing gravity as well. He will have the compensatory strategies that we'll typically see. He'll have a lot of concentric muscle orientation and therefore a lot of limitations in range of motion. Under those circumstances, we probably want to move him away from maximum propulsion to give him the capacity to move through his external rotation to internal rotation strategies. And this allows him to move away from the ground to reduce the concentric orientation and then restore a lot more of the active range of motion that he's missing. So again, it's just a matter of perspective of what we're looking at, but feet are always a great representation of this. They're very confirming as far as some of your measures that you're gonna find on up the chain, so to speak. So some of your top-down influences are gonna be represented in the feet. If you can't manage this from a top-down influence, then maybe it is time to do something about this at the foot. So maybe this is your manual therapies for the foot. Maybe this is selecting activities that are specifically designed to improve the representation of sensation from the ground up. Maybe this is the person that you put in an orthotic as a solution to give them the capacity of adaptability. Performance is an intentional reduction of adaptability to create a higher level of output. Whereas when we're trying to make people more adaptable, such as the rehab situation, now we need to take away some of that reduction in adaptability, restore it to give them the ability to rest, reduce reduce concentric orientation, and then restore ranges of motion. So hopefully that just gives you a little bit of perspective on what we're talking about when we're talking about the performance-related foot and how it might be related to what we're measuring on the table or what we're seeing on the court or in the field. If you have any questions, go to askbillhartman@gmail.com, askbillhartman@gmail.com. Have an outstanding Friday and a great weekend, and I will see you next week.